I'm going to talk about four simple steps to healthier bees. First thing I want to point out before I get too far here is how often in life reality is counterintuitive. I'll tell my prairie dog story. Let's say we want to do a scientific study on how to end up with less prairie dogs. So we put 10 prairie dogs in this cage over here, and we put 10 prairie dogs in this cage over here, and we poison these 10 prairie dogs over here, and they all die. And so I have now scientifically proven beyond a shadow of a doubt that if I poison prairie dogs, I will get less prairie dogs. Is that not correct? Yeah, well, we did this in the West. We poisoned the prairie dogs, and we got more prairie dogs. And the harder we poisoned the prairie dogs, the more prairie dogs we got. And the reason is that it's not just prairie dogs. It's prairie dogs and rattlesnakes and burrowing owls and black-footed ferrets and coyotes and eagles and hawks and all these other things that eat the prairie dogs. And when I poison the prairie dogs, I kill all those things that eat the prairie dogs, and none of them reproduce as fast as the prairie dogs. So reality is often counterintuitive. You think you're doing one thing when actually you're accomplishing the opposite. For instance, if you want the maximum amount of mosquitoes, the thing to do is to go spray for mosquitoes, because you will kill off all of the dragonflies that eat the mosquitoes. You'll kill off all the mosquito eaters that are those things that look like giant mosquitoes that eat mosquitoes. You'll kill off all the things that eat mosquitoes, and even if your insecticide doesn't directly kill them, like the bats, you'll suddenly deprive the bats of all of their food supply. And so the bats will starve to death, and now you'll have less bats. So what you end up with is the maximum amount of mosquitoes, because you have nothing to eat them. So what do we do whenever we have a lot of mosquitoes? We go spray for mosquitoes, and we end up with more mosquitoes, and everybody just insists that that's the reason why we need to spray more. Anyway, I'll say that before I get started here, because I'm going to tell you some things that are counterintuitive. I'm going to say that the number one step for healthier bees is to not treat them. And here's why. One of the reasons is there's 170 kinds of mites that live on bees. There's only three that are a problem, and there's only two of those that are in North America. So whenever you manage to kill the varroa mites, you've managed to kill all these other mites. Some of these mites, the pseudoscorpions for one, we know for a fact eat varroa. Some of them may just displace the varroa. I don't know exactly, we don't really have a map of how all these mites interrelate with each other and with bees. Nobody's ever bothered to research it. What they did when the varroa showed up is they just tried to kill every last mite in the hive, and they've pretty much accomplished that with all of the mites except the varroa. So there's a whole ecology in a hive. We got these 170 mites. We've got at least 30 different kinds of insects that I can think of that I've counted in colonies that I've taken out of trees that are living in this bee colony, because there's not just the bees and the comb. Then there's the detritus at the bottom, and there's all sorts of debris beetles that live in there. There's all sorts of wood roaches and ants, and there's other things that aren't even insects, but there are other creatures that live in there, like centipedes and the sow bugs, and there's just all sorts of things that live in a bee colony in a tree. So you have this whole ecology that's living there. Then we have 8,000 kinds of microorganisms. People are always questioning this. That's why I put all these links up here in case you want to go look them up. Again, you can find this presentation on my website and probably just copy and paste those links. But this is a link to a USDA page that says there's 8,000 kinds of microorganisms that live in a bee colony. And that USDA page is basically referring to Martha Gilliam's research, which is available here on Bee and Others if you'd like to go read some of her research on those 8,000 microorganisms that live with the bees. They've got pretty much all of her research online there where you can go read it. Those 8,000 microorganisms, of all those 8,000 microorganisms, there's only about four or five that are considered pathogens. You know, there's stone brood, chalk brood, AFB, EFB, sac brood. I suppose you can throw in a few other viruses, but most of those 8,000 live there in some sort of a community that is a healthy beehive, that is a healthy bee colony. And anytime you treat anything, you're going to have an effect on that whole ecology. Fumadil is an antibiotic. It was actually targeted at trying to kill Nosema, of course. But Fumadil actually kills almost almost any other microorganism as far as bacteria, yeast, and fungus that live in the colony. Terramycin is pretty much targeted at bacteria, but it's a pretty broad spectrum for bacteria. It'll kill most all of the bacteria. And an awful lot of those beneficial microorganisms are bacteria. Tylosin, of course, is a new one. The terramycin, probably most of the essential bacteria for the colony to survive, has managed to build up a resistance to terramycin over the last 60 years that we've been using it. Where tylosin, they've had no time to build up a resistance to it, and all of a sudden we started using tylosin and killing off a lot more. Also, terramycin's a fairly short-lived antibiotic. It breaks down pretty quickly. Tylosin does not break down very quickly. Essential oils kill microorganisms. They're very useful for that, actually. If you've ever used neem oil and tea tree oil and all those kinds of things, almost all essential oils are antimicrobials. They'll usually kill viruses, yeasts, fungus. Basically, they are the plant's immune system. That's how the plant protects itself from all of those things. And we distill those down and steal them, and it's odd, but it's true. Most essential oils have a lot of the same properties. There are other properties that one might have that this one doesn't have, but antimicrobial is a property they all have. Organic acids tend to kill almost all microorganisms, mostly by shifting the pH to where they can't live. Formic acid is a great thing to sterilize things in. You dip something in formic acid, it pretty much kills everything. It's often used in labs to sterilize things. And that would be the oxalic acid, the formic acid, the max, all those kinds of things. Back to the essential oils, that would include all the thymol stuff. That's an essential oil from the thyme plant. And then you have other essential oils, you know, that some people are using, like lemongrass and peppermint and whatever. Then we get to the acaricides. The acaricides, anything that kills a mite could be called an acaricide, but I'm using it in the context of amitraz, fluvalinate, and cumafos, which are all basically insecticides that they relabeled as acaricides. It's kind of a mystery to me. In the 70s, when I started keeping bees, almost every beekeeper I knew, if you started talking about pesticides, would immediately go off on a tirade about the whole pesticide treadmill and how stupid it was to try and control aphids by spraying them when all you're going to do is kill off all the things that eat the aphids, and then you're just going to have more aphids. And they would all go off on that litany, and then as soon as the varroa mite showed up, they all started dumping those same chemicals in their hives to kill the varroa. It's a mystery to me. I don't understand it. But that's what I mean by acaricides. They're basically things like organophosphates, which were outlawed for use on our food because they were too dangerous. And now we're going to put them in a food container full of insects, and it's an insecticide. But we're going to use it as an acaricide and pretend that it won't hurt the bees. But anyway, these things are all going to affect that ecology. Let's talk some about organisms. Part of the problem is trying to define what's a beneficial organism, what's a benign organism, and what's a pathogen. A beneficial organism is something that usually we classify as that because it directly produces something that's useful. Like you have bacteria in your gut that produces vitamin K, and without it you'll die. That's beneficial, right? Because it directly produces something you need. On the other hand, you have a lot of bacteria that live in and on your body that just are placeholders. They just fill the niche. And if they weren't living there, something bad would be living there. So they aren't producing something specifically good, but just by the nature of filling the niche, they have produced a beneficial effect. If you didn't have staph living on your skin, you would have fungus living on your skin. So the staph that lives on your skin is a beneficial organism, right up until it gets in a cut and starts to infect your cut, and then it's a pathogen. So a lot of these things, these 8,000 microorganisms that live in a colony, are benign in the sense that they don't seem to be doing anything directly good or directly bad, but they fill a niche. Some of them, however, actually have some beneficial effects, even when they're pathogens. Chalkroot showed up back in the 60s in the United States, and when it showed up, EHB almost disappeared. It's making a comeback now for reasons I don't know, but between then and now, there really EHB just ceased to become a problem. And most of it was because if there's chalk brood spores around, even though you don't have an actual outbreak of chalk brood, it tends to prevent EHB. You take stone brood toxin, you take stone brood, the aspergillus that causes stone brood, it's a fungus, and you take the toxin it produces, that is what we're using if you're using Fumadil to try to kill Nosema, because it produces a toxin that kills Nosema. We know that there's bacteria in the gut of the bee that protects them from AFB and EFB. We didn't really know the mechanism until this last year. About 2 years ago, 3 years ago, they discovered that it produces a biofilm in their gut that protects them from things like Nosema. This bacteria produces a film that lines the gut of the bee that protects them from things that attack its gut, like Nosema. But more than that, they discovered that they already knew since Gilliam's research that it somehow protected them from AFB and EFB, but they didn't know the mechanism. Recently, they came up with the mechanism. Basically, what happens is the nurse bees have this in their gut. They feed it to the larva when they're feeding the larva, and it triggers their immune system. When they get exposed to this beneficial bacteria, it triggers their immune system. And then if they get exposed to EFB and AFB, their immune system is already in gear. If they don't get fed that, then their immune system's not in gear. They get fed EFB or AFB, and they immediately succumb to it because they don't have any. They don't have an immune system. Their immune system didn't get put into gear. It didn't get started. Then we've got the yeast and bacteria that they have to make bee bread. Bees really don't eat pollen, and they don't feed pollen to the young brood. They collect pollen, and they turn it into bee bread. Saying pollen is bee bread is like saying sauerkraut is, it's like saying cabbage is sauerkraut. Cabbage isn't sauerkraut. Cabbage is cabbage, but you can make it into sauerkraut. Bee bread is a fermented product that's made by a several stage fermentation of several bacteria and several yeasts that are involved. And so these beneficial organisms are getting disrupted when you try to treat. This is, if you're interested in reading about the biofilm, this is the name of the study, Symbionts as Major Modulators of Insect Health. It's easy to find out on, if you Google that, the entire study's out there and available if you want to read it. And I already kind of talked about sometimes benign organisms crowd out pathogens just by being there. The other thing I think we have to understand is that this is a whole community of microorganisms, and that sometimes this microorganism produces a byproduct that allows this one to live there, which it couldn't live there otherwise. And so you have this whole relation, all these relationships between all of these microorganisms that get very complex. The second of the four reasons for no treatments is to put the selective pressure where it belongs. I'm always kind of baffled by people who are trying to breed varroa-resistant bees and they're still treating their bees, because to me that's a contradiction in terms. I don't see how that's going to work. As long as you're treating them, how are you going to breed bees that don't require treatments when you don't even know if they require treatments because you're still treating them? I don't see any way you can, but if you're even just a little backyard beekeeper and you stop treating and you keep breeding from the ones that are doing well without treating them, you're going to end up with hardier bees than you're going to buy from Georgia that have been constantly treated. It may seem like you can't make that big of a difference, but you can. You can at least control one side of the equation. You got your queens from this stock. You don't know what drones that they mated with, but actually there's a fair chance they could be local feral drones that are living in the tree down the road. And that could really be to your advantage that you're getting that genetics. But you can at least control the genetics on your side. If you quit treating, the ones that can't survive without treatments are going to die. That sounds bad, but that's not. That's probably a good thing. So if you don't treat, you can breed for resistance to all these things. I don't see how you can do that as long as you're treating. The other thing is, as long as you're treating, you're putting the selective pressure on the parasites in the wrong direction. Basically, you're breeding for varroa, who can reproduce fast enough to overcome all your treatments. And I don't think that's really the varroa I want. I want the varroa that can live in harmony with their host. I know it's hard to understand a balanced relationship between a parasite and a host, but a parasite that kills its host is homeless, if not dead. And so it's not to the benefit of the parasite to kill the host, but if you keep creating this unbalanced system where you're trying to kill the parasites all the time, and the parasites are reproducing at a rate fast enough to overcome that, then you're never going to get to that point where you have a host-parasite relationship that's balanced. If your brother-in-law moves into your house and mooches off of you a little bit, that could work out well for him. If he runs you broke and you lose the house, he's homeless. And that's the difference between a parasite that lives in some kind of balance with its host and a parasite that bites the hand that feeds it. You got to be careful if you're a parasite, and not to do that, or you die out. But we keep stacking the deck in favor of super parasites and wimpy bees. And as long as we keep creating that artificial scenario, I don't think we're ever going to get to the solution. In South Africa, all the beekeepers got together when the varroa first showed up and decided that they needed to make up their mind what they were going to do, and they needed to do it as a group. And they decided they were going to not treat. They decided if we don't treat, we'll be over this in a couple of years, and we won't have to worry about it. And in a couple of years, they were over it, and they haven't had to worry about it. And I can't think of any of the bee scientists that I know in this country that I haven't had dinner with that at one time or another hasn't said, if we would never have treated for varroa, we would already be past this. But nobody wants to bite the bullet and do that. The third reason to not treat is to keep the combs clean of chemicals. I mentioned this before from the point of view of doing foundationless combs as being less work, but also that you could get clean wax. Well, the fact is it's about the only way you can get clean wax. But if you treat, we also have the problem that you're adding chemicals to that wax. So even if you started with foundationless, if you treat, that wax is still going to get contaminated because you're adding the contamination. When Marianne Fraser was doing some research on what was coming into the hive, she was just trapping pollen. Bees coming back into the hive, trapping the pollen and seeing what was in the pollen. And what she found in the pollen was the chemicals that the bees are putting in the hive. And you think, well, but that's coming into the hive. But what happens is they're eating honey, nectar, whatever from the hive. They're going out to gather the pollen. They mix it with that because they have to make the pollen solid so they can pack it in their baskets because it's just dust. So they have to make it into mud so they can put it in their baskets. And they bring it back, and it's got coumaphos and fluvalinate and ametraz in it. Why is that? The farmers aren't using those things. They outlawed those things for the farmers. It's the beekeepers that are using those things. And here they are coming back into the hive in the pollen that's being brought back. So the bees took it out with them and brought it back in the pollen. So we keep putting those chemicals in there. We keep contaminating the hive. We keep contaminating that wax, and it just builds up. And the problem with it building up is it eventually reaches the point where you have infertile drones, you have infertile queens, and that causes frequent supersedures, and so you just have a hive that's just struggling to even maintain itself because they keep having to replace their queen who keeps losing her fertility because these chemicals keep destroying the sperm that she's carrying and destroying the what the drones are carrying. So there's also the possibility of shortening the lives of the workers as well. And we don't really know how much, because that's a harder thing to measure than how old a queen is. A queen's easier to keep track of. But so next reason, some of these chemicals obviously interfere with smell. But smell is how the hive operates. Honeybees have 165 odorant receptors. Receptor genes. You know, a fruit fly can smell a rotting banana from about, you know, a mile away. And a mosquito can smell you probably a mile away. Honeybees have twice as many odorant receptors as they do. But we know that a lot of what goes on in the hive is communicated by smell because that's how they That's how they know that the brood needs to be fed. That's how they know they need to go get more pollen, is that they smell the brood pheromone, and that convinces them they need to do that. That brood pheromone drives the workers to not develop ovaries. That queen pheromone drives them to not raise another queen. There's all sorts of pheromones that the queen produces, just the queen. She's got tarsal pheromones on her feet. Everywhere she walks, she leaves a trail that they can smell, and they know the queen's been here. She produces Q and P, which is the thing she shares the most often with them, which convinces them they don't need to raise a new queen. She has a retin-A pheromone she makes that attracts a group of bees to take care of her, to feed her and groom her and curry her. So all these smells are how they communicate. And then there's just the communication of a nectar source. It's true that the forager who comes back with the nectar does this little dance and says it's 200 yards that way and it's really good and it smells like this. And they share some. And that's how they really find it. They go out in that direction and they go that distance and they start smelling for that nectar that they smelled back there. Now you stick some strong smells in there, like essential oils, like thymol that'll run them right out the front door, or formic acid that'll run them right out the front door, or any of the essential oils. Honeybee Healthy is peppermint and lemongrass oil. All of these things not only cover up those smells that they're trying to communicate, but some of them actually simulate some of the brood pheromones, or some of the pheromones that go on in the hive. One of the pheromones that goes on in the hive is an Azinoff pheromone. An Azinoff is what they use when they swarm. It's basically the "we're all here" pheromone. And anytime the hive's been disrupted, they'll do that. If you ever open up a hive and you see bees up on the top with their butts in the air, that's what they're doing, is an Azinoff. And if you pick up a frame and you shake it in there, you'll get about 10 times as many bees up at the top with their butts in the air. Because they know they've been disrupted and they're like, "Hey, everybody, we're over here. We're over here." Because they figure we got to get organized again because something just disrupted everything. And we want to make sure everybody knows where we are and we can all get back together. So you put lemongrass oil in there and it's that exact smell. There are seven components to Azinoff pheromone, and six of them are in lemongrass oil, and only four of them, as far as the scientists are concerned, are actually essential to the what it does as far as getting them organized, and it has all four of those in the lemongrass oil. So the only one it's missing is one that nobody has been able to find any reason that it needs to be there necessarily. So lemongrass oil is a dead ringer for this pheromone that they use to get organized, and you throw that in the hive and you just interfered with their ability to get organized. By the way, just in case you ever think about this, if you ever had a queen fly off, what they want to do is guide her back. What you want to do is guide her back. You want her to make it back, right? So if you take that frame out and you shake it on the top, they all come up to the top, start fanning Azinoff. That will guide her back to the hive. So that's what I would do, and then stand there for about 10 minutes and keep watching. Maybe you'll see her come back, and if you don't, you got a pretty good chance because you stimulated them to do the Azinoff pheromone that she'll probably find her way back. Leave the lid off and incite them to fan. But so what's the downside of not treating? Well, if you want to make the assumption that more of them will die if you don't treat them, I don't think that's true. But if you want to make that assumption, at least the right ones are dying off. You're losing the ones that can't survive without treatments instead of losing the ones you tried to prop up. And I think you're going to be ahead. But if you look at all the surveys I've seen in recent years and look at the big picture, it looks to me like about 60% of the beekeepers out there are no longer treating, which I think is probably a good thing. And if you look at who's losing bees, everybody's losing bees, and they're losing them at the same rate. The people who aren't treating are losing bees, and the people who are treating are losing bees, and I don't see a significant difference between those numbers. Some years, the people not treating have better numbers, and some years, the people treating have better numbers. But all in all, I'd say it's a wash. I don't see a statistically significant difference between the two. The difference, I think, is whether or not you're going to keep the bees that you should be keeping or whether you're going to lose the bees that you should be losing. And I think if you keep propping up the ones that should be dying, then you just keep watering down that gene pool and delaying that final arrival of we get past all this. How many of you treat for tracheal mites? Yeah, see, that's pretty much the number I get anywhere I go. Nobody treats for tracheal mites. Tracheal mites were the scourge that was going to wipe out beekeeping until varroa showed up and everybody quit treating for it. And as soon as everybody quit treating for it, it went away. It took like a year or two and it was gone. No more tracheal mite problems. Why? Because everybody quit treating for them. If everybody would quit treating for varroa today, in 3 years at the most, we'd be over this. But that's not going to happen until people start doing it. So what are the advantages to not treating? Well, the obvious advantages are all the work and all the cost. You got to buy it, you got to put it in, you got to take it out, you got to, and then you have the downsides that you brought along with it. You contaminate your wax, you whatever. So if you don't treat, you get to avoid all that. So that was my first step, was no treatments. My next step is breeding local survivors. And we already briefly talked about that we wanted to put selective pressure where it belongs, and now we need to leverage that. You know, the packages and the bees from other climates have gone downhill so fast that this even isn't even hard to convince anybody anymore. It used to be you had to argue some, because some people who hadn't bought a package in 4 or 5 years would argue, well, they can't be that bad. But pretty much I think it's a consensus now that buying bees from other climates is not working out well. And I don't know how much of it's that they're other climates, or that they're not bred very well, or it's the narrow gene pool. But whatever it is, the local survivors don't seem to have those problems. The ones that are surviving in your trees around here are probably already adapted to your climate. They're already not being treated and surviving without treatments. They're probably the genetics you want, except that you may need to select them for the traits you want, like gentleness and productivity. They may or may not have those traits. But in general, productive bees tend to be successful. And if they're successful, they tend to swarm. And so the bees that are living in the trees do tend to be productive for the most part. They may or may not be gentle, though. That may be something you'll have to select for. But there's plenty of them that are. I've collected a lot of feral bees, and most of them are pretty gentle, and some of them aren't. And the ones that aren't, I tend to call out. I don't put up with mean bees, but they are locally adapted to your climate. Now, even if you bought a bunch of bees from Georgia and you kept them, and they've now, the ones that have survived the last couple of winters are the ones you have, they at least can survive in your climate. And a lot of this is probably genetic predisposition. In other words, their genes tell them when to build up and when to do things, and those things happen to line up well with your climate. In other words, their instincts fit well with your climate, or they wouldn't have survived those last two winters. Some bees make bad decisions that might be good decisions in a different climate. But when I talk about acclimatized bees, I'm not talking about this colony just got used to the weather. I'm talking about the ones that had the wrong instincts died, and the ones that had the right instincts survived. And so you got bees that do the right things at the right time. Now, if you raise your own queens from these, the other advantage you get is you can raise better queens, because you can do them at the optimum times to get good nutrition and to get them well bred. I'd say all the research on queen breeding over the last 100 years has pretty much culminated in this conclusion. Genetics is nice, genetics is helpful, but if you take mediocre genetics and you get a queen that's well fed and well bred, you'll get a really good queen. If you take really awesome genetics and she's not well fed and she's not well bred, you'll get a really bad queen. Genetics is helpful, and it's certainly not unimportant, but it's just one part of the equation of getting a good queen. The other parts of getting a good queen are having her well fed and well bred, and that has a lot to do with timing and or your interference. But timing, if you raise your queens right during prime swarm season, there's going to be plenty of food. There's going to be plenty of drones. They're going to get well fed, and they're probably going to get well bred if you stack the deck that way. If you make sure you've got a good strong colony feeding these queens and there's plenty of nectar out there, they'll probably be well fed. And if it's at a time when there's lots of drones flying, they'll probably get well bred, especially if the weather's good. The problem with buying them from places in the South and places in California is that they're trying to raise as many queens as they can as early as they can because the beekeepers keep demanding them earlier and earlier. So they're raising them at a time when it's not an optimum time to raise them. You can raise them when it's an optimum time. The other thing they really can't afford to do is they're trying to put their kid through college. They don't really have time to try and raise the best possible queen when everybody pays them the same amount for the queen no matter how good she is. So they've got mating nukes. They put a cell in here. The cell emerges. They come back in 2 weeks. They catch her, cage her, and ship her to you. And they've got to get another cell in there so they can get another queen. And that's their object, is to get the most amount of queens they can out of this. Well, you want to get the best queen out of this. If you leave that queen in the mating nuke for 28 days from when you put her in, the research says that she's got much better acceptance rates. She'll live a lot longer. She'll produce a lot more. She'll be a prolific, good queen because her ovarials, when she first starts to lay, start to develop. And if you interrupt that, then they stop developing. But if you let her keep laying, they develop until they reach full development. And that's probably at about 28 days from when she emerged. They probably reach full development. And then statistically, there's not a lot of difference from 28 days on, but there's a lot of difference from 28 days going back. And it gets very dramatic the first week or two. The first week or two is really dramatic, and then the next week is a little less dramatic. The next week is a little less dramatic, and after that, it's probably irrelevant. So if you leave her in a mating nuke, if that's how you're raising them, and for 28 days before you try and do anything with her, then you don't interrupt that development, you end up with a much more prolific queen. If you put those queen cells in a hive you're trying to requeen and you never interrupt her development, then it's the same thing. You don't interrupt that ovarial development, you end up with a much better queen. My point is, you can raise better queens than you can buy. And queen rearing is a whole other topic, but there's some things you can do. The other thing you can do is we can breed for some things that they aren't necessarily breeding for. If you don't requeen all the time and you only requeen when you see a queen failing, and if when you do, you requeen from stock that you know is wise enough to replace their queen when she's failing, you can do what happens in nature all the time, which is select for bees that can sense that the queen's failing and replace her. Because in nature, that is a very strong selection, because if they don't replace the queen in time, they die. If they replace the queen kind of late, they may languish, and the chances of them making it through winter are less because they didn't replace her soon enough. The ones that replace a queen early when she starts to fail and manage to do it seamlessly, which I would call seamlessly, they raise a new supersedure queen. She flies off to mate, she comes back, and then when she's laying really well, they eventually get rid of the old queen. So there really wasn't a big gap of production there. There were two queens laying for a while, and then eventually they get rid of one. You see that all the time. Michael Palmer was the first guy I heard suggest that you could breed for queens like that. And I think he's right. I think you can breed for queens like that. But you can't do it if you keep requeening them all the time. You have to be looking for the ones that are smart enough to requeen themselves and breed from those. So if you breed from queens that have good longevity and they seem to have good supersedure skills, it can actually save you work in the long run, because you don't have to be out there trying to requeen your hives every year. And then there's the obvious. Obviously, it's cheaper to raise your own queens, right? I would hope that's obvious, but the other thing is, it really changes your view of beekeeping when you've got spare queens around. When every time you think you need a queen, it's a panicked search for somebody who will sell you one, and then you buy one, and then you put her in, and they kill her anyway, and then you buy another one, and you put her in, and they kill her anyway, and so on. Well, then it kind of changes your view of what am I going to do under these circumstances. When I've got a queen cell, I've got all sorts of things I can do. I can stick a queen cell in a laying worker hive, and probably it'll emerge and set things right. I can put a queen cell in a hot hive that I can't find the queen in, and odds are it'll emerge, and I'll end up with a queen right and less hot hive. It kind of changes the way you view things when you have some spare queens around, you have some cells around. It can really change your beekeeping. Maybe the most important one is this last one, and that's that you contribute to the overall genetic diversity of the honeybee in North America. You know, there's a place where potatoes come from, and where potatoes grow naturally, there's like thousands of varieties of potatoes there. And of all those thousands of varieties of potatoes that are there, there's about three or four of them that are susceptible to potato blight. And of those three or four, all of the ones that were in Ireland at the time of the potato famine were the ones that were susceptible to potato blight. If they would have had 1,000 different variety of potatoes and the potato blight hit, they would have lost 0.3% of their potato crop. As it was, they lost the entire potato crop and millions of people starved. Why? Because they had too narrow of a gene pool. They had a gene pool that couldn't deal with the new challenge that came along, which was the potato blight. If we want our bees to be able to handle the next challenge that comes along, we need to maintain a broad gene pool. And if you raise local bees here, you'll keep maintaining the gene pool that's already here. If you keep bringing bees in from Georgia, from the same few people who are raising thousands and thousands of full sister queens, then you're just narrowing the gene pool constantly. And I think it's important that we maintain a bigger genetic pool for the bees in order to have some assurance they're going to be able to handle the next wave of disaster that hits us. And if you don't think there's going to be another wave of disaster to hit us, then you haven't paid much attention to the history of beekeeping in the last 100 years. But there's probably going to be another one. This is a quote from Randy Oliver. If you're not part of the genetic solution of breeding mite-tolerant bees, you're part of the problem. That brings us back to, if we would all stop treating, in a couple of years we'd be past this. So why aren't we past this? Because everybody keeps treating. And everybody keeps bringing in bees from other places that aren't able to survive. And that just keeps watering down the gene pool. So you really ought to try and be part of the solution. For those of you who want to raise your own queens, the other thing you can do to be more of a part of the solution here is give away queens to all of your neighbors. Because that way you'll saturate the area, your area, with the drones you want. And you know, what the heck, it's, you know, they're just queens, right? If you're raising a lot of them, you'll probably have more than you know what to do with. I'm going to skip this. You're not in an Africanized beekeeping area. Let's talk about natural food. I don't even understand why this is still even an issue, but they still keep selling pollen substitute. And I think part of it is we have a whole new wave of beekeepers coming in who think that bees are pets and you have to feed them all the time. They're actually foragers who will go forage for themselves. So you really don't have to feed them all the time. Odds are, if there's no pollen out there, they probably shouldn't be doing what they would be doing if there was pollen out there, because it's not time yet. But I'll just leave it at this. Bees raised on pollen substitute are short-lived. The other thing is, I don't understand they're selling packages and they try and sell you all these pollen patties, and you put the pollen patties in with the package and there's stuff blooming out there, so there's fresh pollen available. So of course they totally ignore the patty because there's real pollen and they know the difference. So they go out and get the real pollen. The small hive beetles, on the other hand, love this smorgasbord. So you now have a whole lot of small hive beetles who are just more than happy that you fed them. I don't get it. But anyway, I'll leave it at that. I never had any use for short-lived bees. In the fall, I want long-lived bees that'll make it to spring, and in the spring, I want long-lived bees that'll produce me a crop. I don't really want them to waste their time raising a bunch of short-lived bees when they could have been raising long-lived bees. But let's just talk about sugar syrup. There's probably a world of difference beyond pH between honey and sugar syrup. In fact, I've always been fascinated by the people who say that honey is more, that sugar syrup is better for bees than honey. That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. That's like saying lions are better off eating dog chow than they are eating meat. Maybe, but I seriously doubt it. I think however you want to view it, they were either created to eat meat or they evolved to eat meat, and either way, that's what they eat. So it's kind of silly to act like we can improve on it. In fact, I've heard of us trying to improve on things all my life, and it never has turned out well yet. So. I doubt that sugar syrup is anywhere near as good for bees as honey, but sometimes you have to feed bees. And this is the other thing I have trouble getting across to people sometimes, so I'll try and put this in perspective. I'm not suggesting you constantly feed your bees just in case. I'm suggesting you only feed them when you have to. Now, some of that's going to be developing a sense for that, because if you're a new beekeeper, you really don't know how much you need to get through the winter. And it's going to take you a while to get a feel for that. Even if you talk to local people, which I would, and get a feel for what it takes to get through the winter, you still may find yourself in a position where you're not sure. But I wouldn't just be feeding them constantly, like every winter, steal all their honey and then feed them sugar syrup. I try to avoid that. So to put that in perspective, I fed about four of my hives this last year just because they were kind of light and I didn't feel like juggling honey around because it was getting late. And I just gave them some dry sugar. And for 6 years before that, I didn't feed any of them. And then the year before that, I think I fed all of them. And if that gives you any idea how often I feed my bees, maybe that'll help out. I'm basically suggesting if you need to feed them, you feed them, because otherwise they're you don't want them to starve. If you don't need to feed them, then don't feed them. And yeah, I like I said, you'll probably have to get a feel for some of that, like how much do they need to get through the winter. But you'll get the hang of that, and if you ask around, you'll get advice on that too. But I'm just going to talk about the pH difference. There's other differences. There's all sorts of amino acids and trace minerals and organic acids and whatever that are in honey. But let's just talk about pH. Basically, sugar syrup's around 6.0, and honey's between, I've seen numbers as low as 3, but I think 3.2's, I won't say there isn't any that's 3, but 3.2's is more common. 4.5 is pretty common. That's a typical range for honey, between about 3.2 and 4.5. And it varies depending on the nectar source, so it's not all the same. So sugar's a lot more alkali. Basically, sugar's neutral, and honey's acidic is what it amounts to. But if you look at all the diseases that we're concerned about, AFB, EFB, Nosema, chalk brood, all of that stuff, if you want to culture any of those things, you culture them at 6.0, because they don't live very well at 4.5. They reproduce really well at 6.0. Now that should be obvious in itself, but now we've actually got the research pretty much to back up that basically the 4.5 is what that bacteria that lives in the gut of the bee does well at, and that 6.0 is not what it does well at, and actually it damages that bacteria that lives in their gut, which makes them more susceptible to a lot of these things. But it also makes all these things reproduce better. This is just a quote from Jay Smith making the observation that eventually the research finally backed up, which is that changing the pH of what's in their gut does affect that bacteria that lives in their gut, which does affect their susceptibility to AFB. He's just making the observation that places where they feed a lot more sugar syrup get a lot more AFB than places where they don't. He's a guy who lived in Indiana and was raised in Queens and eventually moved to Florida so he could raise them earlier, because everybody wants Queens earlier and earlier, and he fell into that one. But if you do a search on pH and AFB or EFB or Nosema, you'll see that you culture them at 6.0. So then let's talk about the other 8,000 microorganisms. Anytime you shift the pH, you shift what lives and what dies. And not just bacteria, but yeasts and fungus and whatever. They all thrive at some range, and they all start to fail when they get too far out of that range. And so you shift the proportions of populations, and sometimes you shift whether certain populations are even going to survive when you shift the pH. So shifting the pH to 6.0 is going to change that distribution of all those microorganisms. The argument that's always made for not leaving honey for feed is always that honey's worth more than sugar syrup. I won't argue that, but I do think that they tend to skew the formula, because they just say honey goes for this much a pound and sugar goes for this much a pound and act like it's a straight trade. But in reality, you got to harvest that extra honey. You've got to make that syrup. You got to haul that syrup out there. You got to feed that syrup. You got to deal with whatever issues you created, like robbing, because of that syrup. So I don't think it's that straightforward of a comparison. You can't just say honey goes for this much a pound, sugar goes for this much a pound, so I'm better off feeding them the sugar. Because you also got to take into account all that extra work. But even then, maybe you'd come out ahead financially, I don't know. But if you end up with not as healthy of bees and you have to buy more packages to replace them, I don't know if you come out or not. But so what's the upsides of leaving honey? Well, if you leave them honey, you don't have as much robbing, you don't have as much drowning, you don't have as much work, all the trips to the bee yard, less brood diseases, and you didn't mess up the ecosystem. So my fourth simple step is natural comb. So we did no treatments, breeding local survivors, natural food, and this is natural comb. I'm gonna hit on this very briefly for the moment. There's been a lot of research on this, but all I know is I couldn't solve my varroa problem till I dealt with the cell size issue. But either it helps with varroa or it doesn't. If it doesn't help with varroa, you didn't make it any worse. But let's just talk about foundation. When they invented foundation, they were making it between about 4.4 millimeters and about 5.0. Eventually, it was about 5.1. Most of the stuff in the United States started out at about 5.08, which is getting close to 5.1. And a guy named, up until then, they had no control over the size of a cell. Bees built whatever they built. Huber did his research on natural bees and foundation hadn't been invented. And he's measuring cell size, and he's measuring what they're doing, and he's making the observation that when you get a drone-laying queen, and she's laying drones in worker cells, and the drones are raised in smaller cells, they end up smaller. When they're raised in drone cells, they end up larger. Once in a while, they'll lay a drone in a transition cell, and they end up huge. So obviously, the cell size seemed to have something to do with the size of the drone. So he did an experiment trying to see if he could change the size of the worker by getting them to raise workers in drone cells, but he didn't have any foundation to work with, and the bees pretty much just refused to raise workers in drone cells, so the experiment didn't work out so well. Badeau came along, though, at a time when there was foundation, and decided to repeat that experiment, and his goal really was to get a bee big enough that had a tongue long enough to reach red clover. In Europe, they raise a lot of red clover, and red clover produces a huge amount of nectar, and the honeybees can't really reach it. On rare occasions, if the circumstances are just right, sometimes they can reach a little bit of it for a little while, or sometimes some other insect comes along that chews through the flower and they'll work it a little bit, but for the most part, they just don't work it. And so he was shooting for a tongue long enough to reach nectar, red clover. So he stretched the foundation. And sure enough, he got bigger bees. And so he stretched it some more and got bigger bees. He stretched it some more and got bigger bees. He got all the way up to about 5.7 millimeters and got really huge bees. And then eventually, there's all the bee magazines were arguing about whether this was a good idea or not. People were writing articles and going back and forth on what they thought of the idea. But in the end, they ended up upsizing the bees. This is a recent research. This is the guys who did the research back in the 1800s, early 1900s, Badeau, Pinchot, Gontarski. But this is McMullen and Brown did this one in like early 2000s, I don't remember, 2001, somewhere in there. Partly because everybody was arguing about historically whether this happened or not and how it happened and whatever. So they decided they were going to experiment and see if it actually changed the size of the bees. So they did one recently. If you want to look at all the historic references, I've got a bunch of them on my site, but it's certainly not all of them. There's tons of them out there that you can go find on your own. Almost all the old bee magazines have been scanned in now, so they're easily available, both on Google Books and at Cornell's Hive and the Honeybee collection. You can go read a lot of those old references that I have there. But I think it's safe to assume that the bees know what a natural cell size is. So we can stop arguing about it, and we'll just let them answer the question and leave it at that. The only thing that slightly complicates this is the fact that a bee tends to build a cell based on its own body size. So everybody know what a cubit is? Anybody know what a cubit is? It's the distance from here to here. Well, my cubit may not be the same as your cubit, and a large cell bee probably doesn't have the same cubit as a small cell bee. So a bee that's been unnaturally enlarged won't quite build all the way down to natural size, but they'll build smaller, and then the next turnover of comb, the bees that were raised in that comb will build smaller until you finally get back to what's natural. It may take two or three turnovers, but one way or another, if we quit using foundation, we'll get back to their building what they need to build instead of us making them build something that's not what they need to build. So what's the disadvantage to doing natural comb? Well, I already talked about it from the lazy point of view. It's a lot less work, but it does require a few changes in the way you do things if you're used to using foundation. Because if you're used to using foundation and you have a frame in your hand and you turn it like this to get the sun just right, it works fine when you have foundation. But when you don't have any foundation and they just started this comb and it's not attached yet and you do that, then it tends to break the comb off, especially if it's heavy and it's got nectar in it. But even if it's not, it can be really soft. So you need to pay attention, and if it's not connected, then you don't turn it like that. And once it's connected on the bottom, you can probably turn it, and that's probably not going to be a problem unless it's really, really heavy, and there's no real reason to turn one that's really heavy. I mean, usually if you're turning it, it's to try and get the sunlight in the bottom of the cell so you can see the eggs, and usually that's not a real heavy comb. So if it's touching at all on the bottom where it's connected on the bottom, you can probably do that. So it requires you to change how you do this if you have habits. Now, if you're a new beekeeper, you probably don't have any habits, and it won't be that hard. The first time you break one off, you'll be heartsick, and you'll never do it again. But if you're an old beekeeper, I'll hand you a foundationless comb, and you'll break one off, and I'll hand you another one, and you'll break one off, and about the third one, you're so mad you can't see straight. But you've just got a habit that you haven't broken yet. You need to, every time you pick up a comb, if you're going to do foundationless, you should look at it and think about it before you do anything. Think about it. Is this connected? Can I tip this? Is it heavy? Is it soft? Is it, you know, how strong is this comb? Because if it's old yellow or even dark black brood comb and it's attached on all sides, you can do whatever you want with it. It's going to be fine. But if it's really soft and heavy, you're not going to be able to shake the bees off of this comb of honey if it's all white and soft and heavy and not very well attached. You're going to have to think about it and go, oh, maybe I better brush this one and brush the bees off of that one. Next one I might be able to shake off just fine. So you have to make an adjustment in your thinking. And most of that comes down to the fact that it is fragile at first when they first draw it. Once it's attached on three sides and it's got some yellow color to it, it's fine. It's no more fragile than wax foundation. You do need to level the hives this way and this way. Not this way and this way doesn't matter so much, but this way and this way, if it's leaning, bees build combs that are in line with gravity. So if the frames are all tight in this box and the box is leaning like this and they build a comb from this top bar to the bottom bar of the next frame, it creates a mess. It's hard to deal with. So if you have it level, then it tends to stay in the frame. I just stick a level on it and make it level. Besides, you ought to level them anyway because let's assume you have foundation and all of that doesn't matter. The fact is, a hive that's tipped like this has more weight on this side than on this side, which makes it sink more, which makes more weight on this side, which makes it tip more, because this keeps sinking. And the more you get it level, the less that happens. The more it'll sink down evenly and stay level. So you may as well level them up anyway, but you will have to pay attention. That's probably a bigger issue if you're moving them around. If you're hauling them to some orchards, then you may not want to haul your hives that are on brand new empty frames and haven't drawn their combs yet. But you could probably take some that are on foundationless, but their combs are all already drawn, and you just want to drop them off in the orchard or wherever you're taking them. But that may be an issue if you're just setting them off on pallets, that if you have to level them up, that may be a problem. I already talked about less work before, and the clean wax I talked about some before. And of course, clean wax leads to healthier bees. We kind of already talked about some of this, but there's one other way you can get clean wax, and that's once you start with some clean wax, you let them draw some of their own comb, and you get that wax, and you make your own foundation. You could do that. But if you've never made foundation, now we've taken that all of that work of crimping the wire and embedding it and all, it was already a lot of work. Now we've added a whole nother amount of work again about that much, because now you gotta dip boards to get the sheets, and then you gotta run the sheets through the press, and then you gotta cut the sheets to fit because they're never the right size because it kind of squishes them and it changes their size. So now you gotta cut them to fit. And so it's a huge amount of work. The only people I know of who do that, it pretty much consumes their life. They have no time for anything else. But you can do that. I talked already some about this. The fact is, a queen can't lie about her fertility, and so if she's not very fertile, she gets replaced all the time because the bees can tell she's not fertile, and so they keep replacing her. And as long as there's chemicals in there that keep contributing to her being infertile and her drones being infertile, then they just keep replacing her. And so you get all these frequent supersedures because of the contamination in the comb. And the only way to avoid that contaminated wax is to let them build their own comb. I'm concerned about the overall longevity of the workers. If you think about an economy of a bee colony, and it is an economy, a worker emerges. It does some work as a nurse bee. It does some work as a house bee. It does some work as maybe drawing some comb if there's comb that needed to be drawn. Maybe it's a guard bee, and then it finally flies out and starts foraging the last half of its life. And now the first half of its last half of its life, it's just hauling in enough food to feed all those other nurse bees and raise all those other bees to replace it and maintain the colony. It's still not making a surplus yet until the last part of its life, it's finally making enough to make a profit for the colony. If you shorten the life of all of those bees by one day, you've taken a chunk out of that profit. If you take a week off of there, you may have lost all your profit. Now you've got chemicals in this wax that are shortening the lives of the queens. We know it shortens the lives of the queens, but they live long enough that it's kind of obvious and easier to measure. I don't know how much it's shortening the lives of the workers, but it can't be improving them. It's basically insecticides, and it's not gonna improve their longevity. And I already kind of talked about this. Maybe I'll talk about just if you've got a wax comb, you can cut out and leave a cell all the way around and use that as a comb guide, not bother to put a guide in. I don't really recommend the last one, but I've seen some people do this. They cut the middle out of a plastic frame and leave just an edge, a row of cells around the edge. I think it's more work than it's worth, but that's various ways you can get some kind of comb guide on a frame so you can get natural comb. And I showed you that one before. This is that comb right after it's drawn, or just before I extracted it. You notice there's a little hole there. That's a communication hole, and there's a little communication hole there, and there's a little hole there, and there's a little hole there. But this is attached all the way across here, and it's attached all the way up to there, and it's attached all the way up to there, and you'll notice it's kind of a yellow tint to it. This is good, solid comb that's ready to be extracted. It works just fine. I don't like wires. You could put wires in them. I don't like wires in them because they always seem to get in my way. If this was a nice, soft, white one, I'd like to cut it up for comb honey, and the wire's in my way when I want to do that. Or this is in the brood nest, and there's a queen cell right here, and there's a wire running right through it. I can't cut that queen cell out. I'd love to be able to cut. There's five queen cells on there. I'd love to be able to cut them all out and put them in separate little mating nukes, but I can't do that if there's wire in my way, so I don't care for the wire. But you can wire them if you want. I extract them all the time. There's always people asking, you know, you can't extract them, right? No, I extract them all the time. I don't see any real difference between that and wax. Neither one are indestructible. I can blow either one of them out if you want to prove that it doesn't work. But if the point is to make it work, you just got to be gentle and pay attention to what you're doing and start slow and work your way up. Now, if you haven't bought an extractor and you're looking at an extractor, if it doesn't have a variable speed on it, I wouldn't buy it. I don't have any use for an extractor that only has high. That's just going to blow out. But apparently they exist. This is why I mentioned it. You want to start slow when it's heavy and has all that weight of honey in it, and you want to get it about half empty before you start cranking it up very much. The drone thing is one of the things that always comes up is if you put a foundationless frame in the middle of your existing colony, and they've got nothing but worker comb from that nice foundation you gave them that was all laid out in workers, and they've been wanting to make drones for a while. They have two thresholds they're trying to meet. One of them is enough drone comb so that if they ever need any drones, they have a place to build them. And the second one is they want enough drones for the time of year it is. And it depends on the time of year how much they want. In the spring, it could hit 25% of them could be drones right at the peak of swarm season. But it probably tends to be closer to about 20. And by summer, it's probably dropped off to maybe 10. And by fall, it's probably dropped off to maybe 5. And then they kick all of them out and kill them. So the amount they want varies during the year. But if you stick an empty comb in the middle of a brood nest in the spring, odds are they're going to draw nothing but drone comb on it, and they'll probably fill it full of drones because it's an itch they've been wanting to scratch. It's a threshold they've been trying to meet, and you finally gave them the opportunity to do it. So now if you pull that out because you don't want them to raise drones and you think drones are evil and wrong, obviously the bees don't agree with you, but and you put another comb in there, guess what they'll do? they'll draw it all drones because you still didn't let them have their drones. So if you put that on the side and then you let them draw the next one all drones and you put it on the side, eh, they'll probably quit doing that and start raising some, start making some worker comb. Once they hit about 20% drone comb, they're going to stop for sure. That's usually about the point at which they've got plenty. I'd say all my boxes have at least two drone frames in them. The two outside ones are almost always drone, and sometimes there's another one in there. And I just leave them in there. I know everybody tells you that drones are bad, and that's where the varroa reproduce, and you'll have horrible varroa problems. And I have 20 to 25% drone comb in all my hives. I let them raise all the drones they want, and I have no varroa problems. So I think they're mistaken. I understand that they can reproduce better in drones, but I also understand that in Serrana, they only reproduce in the drones, and the Serrana don't have a real issue with varroa. And that's where that's varroa's natural host. So I don't know. I don't worry about it. But then there's always the issue of the messing them up. Well, I don't understand the people who use foundation who keep saying this. If they've been keeping bees very long, they've seen them mess up everything. So I don't know why they say that. It's like they don't mess up plastic, like they don't mess up wax. Wax never gets hot and buckles, and then they build comb on it, and then you end up with a mess. No, that never happens. And then the fins that they want to build on the plastic, or even on the plastic or the foundation. Sometimes they'll build this comb that comes out, and it's like on the surface of this foundation that's over here, and you can't see behind it because it creates this cul-de-sac. But they didn't like the foundation, so they built what they wanted out here. Anytime you give them the chance to build their own comb without foundation, they will avoid the foundation and build their own comb because they don't like foundation. I don't care what anybody says. They don't like foundation. They leave an empty space in a box full of foundation, and they will ignore the foundation and build a comb in that space, either hanging from the box above it or whatever, wherever they have to attach it. So I don't think they mess it up any more than they do foundation. There is one thing you need to realize, though. If they build one messed up comb, they build parallel combs. So if they build a comb from corner to corner, the next one's going to be from corner to corner, and the next one's, they're all going to be in line with that one because they build parallel combs. So if you've got a top bar hive or you've got a foundationless box and they built one wild comb across there, I meet these people all the time who say, I keep hoping they'll get they'll figure it out. Well, they already figured it out. They're going to build them just like that one. They're going to build them all parallel. So if you don't like that, you're going to have to intervene. You can't just leave it. They'll just keep building parallel combs. The advantage to foundation is that every one of them is a clean slate. They might build one off here, but the next other side, they got to make a decision. Do we build on the foundation or do we build it in between? So at least they got a chance to get back on track. Sometimes they never do. Sometimes some bees just, some of it's genetic, I think. Some bees just don't like whatever it is you're trying to do, and they do whatever they want to do. Some bees just want to build stuff every which way, and it's hard to deal with them. But the fact is, I don't think they mess it up any more often. But if you get one bad comb, you need to get it straight in the cut it out, rubber band it into the frame so it's running in the right direction. Or better yet, every time you add a box of foundation, let's take a drawn comb from the box below it and put it in that box so you have a line established so that they'll follow it. They'll build parallel combs. I don't think they mess it up any more often, but they will mess up the whole box once they mess up one if you don't intervene. So how fast can you get all this done? If you want to go to not treating and raising your own queens and whatever, I think you got to decide how aggressive you want to be. I would be somewhat aggressive because I think the sooner you get all of this done, the sooner you'll get past some of your problems. But if you get too aggressive, I think you stress out the bees. So you don't want to go in there and like pull out take all their brood and shake them all off of their combs and make them start over, which some people have been known to do. But I think that's too much stress. I think you want to feed those empty frames into the brood nest and eventually get it where it's all natural comb. And if you do that fairly aggressively, in about 2 years, you could probably change them all over without stressing them very much. If you wanted to get a little more aggressive, you might even be able to get it done in one. And if you wanted to take it a little bit easier, you could take as long as five. If you replaced comb at the rate that the typical experts are recommending you should rotate your comb out anyway, you'd be done in five without any extra effort beyond what they already recommend you should do. You just feed in a fifth, 20% of them every year, and in 5 years you've done all of them. So that's kind of up to you how aggressive you want to get. But I had this problem. I had a whole bunch of plastic large cell foundation, and I kept meaning to give it to somebody or sell it to somebody who was going to buy it anyway, but I keep trying to talk people into not using it. So I finally ended up throwing it away, but it seems like a waste because there's probably some factory somewhere still making more of it. And so, but you can sell it to somebody, or you can, if it's wax, you can always turn it into candles, or you can make rolled candles. Anybody ever make rolled candles? You just take the foundation. If it doesn't have wires in it, if it has wires in it, it's a whole other ball game. But So this is pretty much a upside minus the one downside. If cell size really doesn't matter, well, then I still don't see it's going to hurt to have natural size cells. You probably ought to rotate your combs out anyway. It's less work than foundation. It's not contaminated. So I don't really see a downside other than it's not going to, if it doesn't help with your varroa, that's not a downside. That just wasn't an upside. Best case scenario is that it does help you with your varroa problems, and you still get all the rest of the upsides, the clean wax, the healthier bees, because it's not contaminated and it's less work. So that was my four steps. I have a page just on, if you go to my website, there's a page on almost any of these individual topics. There's a page just on natural cell size. There's a PowerPoint on natural cell size. There's a page just on foundationless. Most of these you can get to just by going to the menu. If you go to bushfarms.com and you go to bees and then you go down the left-hand side, there'll be one that's just foundationless beekeeping. And then there'll be one that's natural cell size. It'll be down under the pests section. And then the PowerPoints are all under presentations. If you go down the left-hand side and go to presentations, there's all these PowerPoints that I've been doing, plus some other PowerPoints that we probably haven't done and won't do, like the natural cell size one. So, now, how well does all this work? I won't go through all these because I'll bore you. I think I'm missing the last couple of them, but this is my health certificates. This is how many colonies he examined. I have to give him inspected because I sell queens, so he comes and inspects them. I have to actually pay him to inspect them because they got rid of the inspection program, and so now the Department of Agriculture pays this guy who happens to be on their staff in the entomology department, who's a beekeeper, to come out and do the inspection. I have to pay $150 just to get him inspected. But anyway, this is how many inspected, how many Africanized honeybees there were, which colonies, which was zero, you know, so on and so forth. So basically, I've got I'm having trouble reading that. Somewhere on there's varroa. Oh, here we go, varroa mites. He did powdered sugar and he didn't find any. But pretty much it runs that way most of the way through here. It looks better from back here than it did up there. Yeah, it looks good.
Did you ever treat for varroa?
For about 2 years I did, because I got desperate because they all kept dying. And then when I treated them and they died anyway, I decided that wasn't really helping me any. So then I quit.
Did you use oxalic acid thing?
I used oxalic acid 1 year, yeah. It was pretty effective, but I'm concerned about what it does to the whole microorganisms.
I see where they just approved it.
They've approved it both as dribbling and vaporization. I just did vaporization. I never tried the dribbling. It was obvious it damages their mouth piggy and tubules enough that they don't survive the winter if you treat them more than once. And that makes me wonder how much I damaged them by treating them once. But I have tried that, yeah. And it was one of the more effective ones. This is varroa again.
When you do a honey harvest, do you use fume boards? Or how do you do a honey harvest?
I'm sorry, the
question. You were talking about essential oils. And I was just wondering, when you do a honey harvest, do you use fume boards? Or how do you do your honey harvest? And if we are using fume boards, then what are we doing?
I've never used fume boards, no. I in the old days, I used to just brush them off. I'd just take them and brush them off. I've done abandonment where it worked well and where it didn't work well. If you do abandonment and you do it during a flow, basically you go in and you just, like an hour before dark, you pull all the supers off and stand them on end in front of the hive, wait for dark, and then load up all the supers. They just all go back to the hives. But if you do that in a dearth, it sets off a robbing frenzy that will scare you half to death. So it's a little bit of a scary proposition to do abandonment, but that's one of the reasons I also do it like an hour before dark, because it's a pretty good bet that it won't set off too much of a frenzy, because it'll all be over by dark, hopefully. But then they may go back at it against each other the next day and turn into a robbing frenzy. That I've done that successfully and not successfully, depending on when I did it. First time I did it, it was unsuccessful, and I didn't realize it was all in the timing. And then the next time I did it, I was more careful about the timing, and it worked pretty well. I brushed them, where you just brush all the bees off of them. I pounded them. It's probably much more effective than brushing them. You get your thumb under the end bar lug here, and you get a hold of the top bar with your fingers right here, and you just hit your hand like this, and they all fall off. And if you do a double hit, you get a little higher percentage. You just do a bang, bang, and the whole idea is to surprise them, and pretty much they all fall off, and then you stick it in the box that's got a lid that you're putting them in to keep them away from them. But I kind of gave up on that and started harvesting late. I just wait till it's cold enough, the bees are all clustered, not in the supers, and I just pull the supers off. It's a lot less work, but it requires a little bit of luck too, because weather's unpredictable. You know, it could go from it's too nice to do that to it's too cold to do that, and you know, that's the problem with those kind of plans, is sometimes you're planning on that perfect day, and that perfect day just doesn't happen. But usually that perfect day does happen, and so usually that works pretty well. But yeah.
What months do you usually harvest then?
Probably October.
Really?
Yeah. I usually want to wait. The problem is that our last hard freeze could vary a lot, but I'm kind of looking for the fall flow to be over, because it allows me to judge what to leave and what to take better if the fall flow's already happened than it is if I'm presuming on what the fall flow's going to be. If the fall, because I could have a fall flow that makes me a bumper crop, or I could have a fall flow that fails completely. And if it fails completely and I take too much honey, well, then I'm back to trying to get them through the winter on not enough food, and if I wait until October to do that, I can't really feed them that late, other than giving them dry sugar, because I've already kind of pushed it too late in the year. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Everything you do affects everything else you do. It's a cascade.
Yes, it's a chain. Thank you.
That's part of why I went to the dry sugar, was I was pushing it too late to doing the harvest to feed them sugar syrup, and so had to make up the, he's running back there with a mic, I think. We got a question here.
I'm just beginning, and I'm wondering, I understand if you're going to foundationless, that working in the brood boxes is not a problem, but how, you said that you had to have a closed cell honey cap up on top before you put in the foundationless frame, otherwise you would have problems. And I'm just wondering what one does when one doesn't have a stockpile of...
It doesn't necessarily need to be capped, but if you're going to put it between draw and comb, it needs to be capped, because otherwise it'll just keep making it fatter. But if you just put a whole box of foundationless up there, they'll probably just build comb on it, and that's not necessarily a problem. Yeah. It's nice to put one drawn comb in the middle, and one drawn comb in the middle, even if they make it fatter, I'll just deal with it, because I can still get the other frames out, and then it might come out with three frames, but these aren't really, they didn't build on them. That's all right, I don't care. I can deal with that. What I can't deal with is if I put empty drawn and then an empty frame, and empty drawn, an empty frame, empty drawn, and an empty frame, and then they fatten all of those existing ones out. I can't get any frame out, and I can't really harvest the box very easily.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
In fact, actually, I tend to space them a little wider in the supers, because they're easier to uncap, and they tend to want to space them. They tend to want to make them thicker anyway. So if I space them about an inch and a half in the supers, they tend to like that pretty well. If I go wider, if they're drawn, I can go wider. If they're not drawn, it's hard to go wider than about an inch and a half. But
Mike, what's your thought about? This is loud. What's your thought about rotating wax out, the black stuff? Do you get rid of it after a certain period or not?
I don't. No. I think if you're putting any chemicals in the hive, you definitely need to. I know the other argument will be that that they're bringing in chemicals from the farmers, and that could be, but I think the majority of the problem most people are facing are chemicals that the beekeepers are putting in the colony, and I'm not putting anything in there, so I'm not too worried about it. I know there's this idea that it's dirty, but it's not really dirty, it's just full of cocoons.
Right. Yeah.
But it's true, if you're putting chemicals in there that are lipophilic, it's going to build up in the wax, you know, like amitraz, fluvalinate, and so on. But
we're also new beekeepers. We'll be getting two nucleus colonies shortly. And in regard to feeding the bees when they arrive, you know, we've been instructed to feed them with the sugar syrup. But I appreciate what you said about feeding them honey. But we've also been warned about buying store-bought honey because it has, you know, toxins and contaminants in it. So where do we get the honey to feed them?
Well, actually, I didn't ever talk about feeding honey. I talked about leaving them honey. Leaving them honey is an entirely different proposition than feeding them honey. I don't like to feed them honey because it tends to set off robbing, and that's not to my advantage. So feeding honey is problematic. I know they'll tell you that it's all about AFB, but actually, if you're not treating them with antibiotics, they usually don't get AFB anyway because you didn't kill off the bacteria that was protecting them from it. So I'm not so worried about the AFB as I am that I'm going to set off robbing. So I don't like to feed honey. So
then how do you start off a nucleus colony? You know, once you've installed it.
Well, so right now you got stuff blooming here, so
okay. So no feeding.
I'd probably feed them what they came with and see what happens. If it rains for a week, I'd probably be out there feeding them because they won't get out to get anything and they've got no stores. But if the weather's staying nice and it doesn't rain more than a day in a row, then they'll probably just forage and do fine.
Okay, so sugar syrup when you have to, but otherwise honey that they've already made.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, if you've got frames of honey for, you know, like from last year or something, yeah, give them frames of honey, but I wouldn't feed them honey, no.
Okay, thank you.
As much as I tell you I don't like the sugar syrup, it's still better than having them starve.
We have an issue with small hive beetles, and last year there was some information about these beetle baffles that you could build onto the bottoms of your boxes.
Right.
Do you know if they work or?
I don't know. I don't have any beetle problems. We have beetles, but we don't have any problems. And I've seen one slimed mating nuke, and I've seen two hive beetles ever in any of my hives, all totaled. So no, we just don't have any problems. And I think it's a combination of how hard the winters are and the clay soil. I don't know, because they are around, but they just don't ever seem to be a problem. So I don't consider myself qualified to give advice on small hive beetles, because nobody else, you know, I can blame it on the stuff I'm doing and say I'm just a great beekeeper, but the fact is nobody else I know in Nebraska is having problems either. So I think it's just the climate or the soil or something.
I had that problem one time. I just put a ball and put the hive in a new crowded room, and then the bees took care of
it. I think that's a lot of it. Keeping a strong hive is a big part of wax moths, hive beetles, all those kinds of things. Yeah.
You talked about the black cells that are empty. Is that something that the bees will clean out, or am I supposed to clean those out?
You don't have to worry about it. They'll be black. That's what they are. They're just full of cocoons.
What do you mean cocoons?
Well, a bee's an insect, so when the larva does a transformation, it spins a cocoon, and then it pupates.
Okay.
And then it emerges, and that cocoon gets left behind.
Okay.
But the bees are cleaning it out to a certain extent, but they only clean it out to a certain extent. And if you've got large cell comb, that extent is that it gets really, really thick before they clean it out, because they have a threshold of how small they'll let the cell get before they clean it out. And since you started with an overly enlarged cell, they just keep getting smaller and smaller until they finally reach that threshold. If you started with a natural-sized cell, that would only be a few layers of cocoons, but if you start with an oversized cell, that's hundreds of layers of cocoons before it reaches that point. So you get really thick layers of cocoons. The other thing is they're chewing them out all the time, regardless of whether they need to or not, just to make the cappings for the brood comb, because the cappings have to breathe. So when you get a new package and you put them in a colony, for you newbies who are just starting and you've never seen this, I'll warn you so you'll see this coming and you can watch it. You put a package and they build this nice, beautiful white comb and you think, oh, that's just gorgeous. And then they cap it with these nice, almost white, maybe yellow cappings. And you think, that's really gorgeous. And it is, it's beautiful. And then the next, that batch emerges and now the comb's a little bit brown because it's got one cocoon in it. And that makes it just a little bit brown. And so the next batch of cappings are just a little bit brown. And the reason they're a little bit brown is that first batch of cappings, they had no cocoons to chew out. So they went and got pollen and mixed it with the wax to make the capping so it would breathe. But now they have cocoons. So now they chew out cocoons and mix it with the wax to make the cappings so that it will breathe. And so now it's kind of a light brown. And then the next batch will be darker brown, and you'll finally get where your cappings are really, really dark. And you'll write me and tell me you think your bees have some horrible disease and they're all going to die because now your combs are black and your cappings are brown, and that wasn't the way it was when you started. They were all just cream colored and white. But that's just the progression of comb getting older and the way they make the cappings. But because the cappings have to breathe because the larva has to breathe. So they make it breathe by adding something to it, and what they add depends on what's available. When there's cocoons available, they use those. So, okay.
Thank you.
Sure.
What do you think of the use of screen bottom board and sticky board to help catch varroa mites that fall down?
I don't think it makes any difference on the varroa mites. If you want to monitor varroa mites, I think they're helpful. I'm recommending you don't treat, but if you want to use like powdered sugar or something, it's a whole lot easier it's probably more effective because it can fall through the bottom. If you pull the tray out and you put the powdered sugar on, they'll fall through the bottom. It's probably more effective with any treatment if you have a screen bottom, because especially if you take the bottom out while you're treating them, because they'll fall all the way through to the ground. Because if you put any kind of treatment in there, it's going to knock, some of them it's going to kill, and some of them it's just going to knock them down and they're going to crawl back up. And if the ones that get knocked down fall through, it'll probably be less of a problem. But all in all, if you're not treating, I don't think it makes any difference one way or another. And if anything, there's some research that shows you'll probably end up with more varroa because the cooler temperatures tend to help the varroa reproduce better. But it's kind of contrary to some of the early research, but more and more that's the direction the research seems to point to, and that's what my experience would be. I don't think it really makes any difference on the varroa. I've got about half and half, and I'm still running half and half. I'm not going to get rid of them. They're perfectly good bottom boards, and I already have them. So I'll just keep using them, but I'm not buying any more of them now. I'm buying solid.
So I'm going to cheat and ask two questions. First is the size of your mating nuke. Is it 5 frames?
No, it's 2 frames.
Okay, you already use it. And are you having successful queen return on those?
Sure.
Okay. And then on the foundationless drone comb, are you reusing that in the hive, and where are you putting it if you are?
I always move it to the outsides. I never take it out.
Okay.
So you just recycle. I've never culled a drone comb in my life. I don't plan to. Okay. I just move them to the outside. I'd rather have them on the outside because if they're in the middle and they're empty, the queen may just lay them full because they happen to be there, and I'd rather they were on the edges of the brood nest where she has to go find them and lay in them.
Yeah, that's what she was doing in mine.
I just want to make sure that's a decision they made. Because normally when they build comb, there isn't an empty space in the middle unless a comb falls out, you know? They build comb, it's usually brood, 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 and then some drone. And so I stick an empty one in the middle when they don't have any drone, and they go, oh, there's a place we can build some drone. And now the queen comes along and says, oh, there's some drone I could lay. Where if I put it on the outside, she kind of has to go find it, which if she wants to, that's fine. But meanwhile, she's not going to it's not going to be break. This is the other thing is if it's in the middle of the brood nest and they don't want her to lay in it, then they have to backfill it with nectar. Well, now I've made this wall of honey in the middle of the brood nest that doesn't seem like the right place for it. I'd rather it was on the outside too. So I just always move them to the outside, if that makes sense. So that my two outside frames are almost always drone combs. That's the way it ends up. Other questions?
Just a real quick one. How often do you go into your hives? How often do you manipulate them?
How often should I, or how often do I?
Let's say both.
Ideally, I probably ought to go through them once in the spring just to see how everything is and make sure they're all queen right and things are going well, because if I catch it early and they're queenless, I could probably throw a frame of brood in there, maybe get them set right. Sometimes some of them are going to be drone laying queens because they raised a queen late. She didn't get mated until late, and now she's a drone layer, and I could probably fix that if I caught it early before they get a whole hive full of drones and not enough workers. So I'd probably, like a week ago would have been a good idea, but I was running around speaking. And here that would probably be 3 weeks ago or 2 weeks ago, I don't know. That would probably be a good first inspection, and then I'd probably, it wouldn't hurt to, you know, there's inspecting all of them, which probably ought to be done that first time, and then there's just looking at a few of them in each yard to see what's going on. You know, you look at one that's obviously doing well, lots of bees coming and going, and one that's not doing so well, and there's not as many bees coming and going, then I probably want to look at the one that seems to be having trouble. Or if I see one that's a real boomer that seems to be, you know, weeks ahead of everything else, I might want to check them to make sure they're not swarming. That would be more of a choice of that one needs to be looked at and that one needs to be looked at, but I probably don't need to look at all of them, you know, which is a little different than the first time I probably needed to go through all of them just to make sure everything's, you know, kosher. That would probably be a good plan right in the middle of, in my case, probably the middle of May, which is probably about the first of May for you guys, because they might start swarming any time after that, and I kind of want to catch that. If it looks like this really booming one looks like it's getting ready to swarm, well, then I might want to be looking at the rest of them too. And then I'd probably open up the brood nest, throw some empty frames in the brood nest to get them to expand the brood nest a little more and try and avoid them swarming. So if I was doing it well, that's probably what I would do then. And then some of them I might split at the same time, just because if they're already deciding to swarm or they're far enough ahead, I think they're likely to swarm no matter what I do, I'd probably split those. So that's probably about mid-May. About the 1st of June, I probably need to get out there and start putting supers on, because my main flow is going to hit in about 2 weeks. The weather's already pretty warm. They should be pretty full. I could probably pile supers on about the 1st of June. And again, I probably would look at it from the point of view of, I probably don't need to look at all these hives, but maybe if that one looks like it's really, really booming, I might want to check it to make sure they're not trying to swarm. And if that one's not looking so good, I might want to check it and see if something's wrong, you know, but I probably wouldn't go through all of them. I'd probably pile the supers on, and then I'd probably come back in the fall and harvest. So.
Okay, so if I followed you in the beginning, it's about every 2 to 4 weeks, and then you wait until the fall-ish.
Okay. Sure.
Okay. I mean, that's what I thought I heard, but
in a,
all right.
In a bad year, I don't get to them at all. I leave the country, and I'm not even here. So
okay. That's the other end of the spectrum.
So that's the other extreme. But
all right. Thank you very much.
Sure.
We're hands-off beekeepers and recreational beekeepers would like to keep 3, 4, 5, or 6 hives just for personal and family use. And I'm not really that interested in learning how to rear queens or create new hives. What are recommendations you would give someone like myself to reduce a hive's tendency to want to swarm?
Well, the thing you need to understand about splits is you can always do combines later. So it's not like you have to constantly increase the number of bees you have. But honestly, I'll bet you if you went into winter with twice as many bees as you want, and you came into spring and you still had twice as many bees as you want, you'd be doing really well. And then you could sell them to any of these other people out here who would love to buy some local bees. But you can always do a combine come fall. If you've got a couple of mediocre hives, you just combine them and they'll be a little stronger going through winter and you'll have a few less hives. But frankly, I think as difficult as it has gotten to get bees through the winter in this country, I think it'd make more sense just to go into winter with twice as many bees as you want and sell off the excess come spring. But I think that's the simplest solution. But and you may not have any excess. You might, but you know, if you do, then that's not. The other thing you can do is do a combine just before the flow. If you can figure out where the flow is going to be and you wait until just about when the flow is going to be and you do a combine, then you get a really strong hive that will make a lot more honey. And then it'll wind down to fall and you've got less hives because you did that combine. Every time you do a combine, you're going to have less hives. And you can do a combine just about any time except prime swarm season. If you do a combine in prime swarm season, you can pretty much guarantee they're going to swarm. But because you just crowded them. You just gave them the resources to swarm. So, but if you do that right before the main flow or right at the main flow, then odds are they're just going to have twice as many workers to go work the flow, and they'll probably make you more honey. So
the manipulation of the box to reduce their tendency to want to swarm is by adding, giving them places to lay brood and places to build more, store more honey.
Sure. Put empty frames in the brood nest, and you'll tend to avoid them wanting to swarm. Once the main flow hits, you can usually just pile on the supers because they're usually past deciding to swarm, as long as you don't let them get too crowded, as long as you make sure there's plenty of supers. But plenty of supers isn't enough to keep them from swarming during prime swarm season, but it's enough to keep them from swarming during the flow usually. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Prime swarm season, they're in the reproductive mode. They want to reproduce this superorganism, and once they get kind of past that and they decide, oh, it's time to put away the honey for winter, then it's just a matter of not letting them get too crowded. Because then if they get too crowded, they may start saying, oh, well, we got plenty of honey for winter. The whole place is full, and I think we could pull off a swarm. And then they try to swarm. But
make a split and then later combine it. Do you kill the old queen?
I thought I made it clear. I never look for a queen if I don't have to. So I wouldn't have to. So I wouldn't. No, I'd just do a combine. They'll sort it out. And that's just because I'm lazy. I suppose if I had nothing better to do, I might go find the queen just for the practice. Well, definitely if I had a strong preference for one of them over the other one, if I really like this queen and I'm not so sure about that one, then I'd probably try and find the one I don't really care so much about and get rid of her. But otherwise, if I'm ambivalent on which one's better, I'm probably just going to combine them and let them sort it out.
Short of going into the hive, like I'm from Virginia Beach, and like yesterday it was, I was looking at the hive, without trying to see which ones were bringing in nectar. I could see them bringing in pollen, but I mean, is there certain bees that just bring in nectar, or how do you tell if they're, I couldn't tell if they're bringing in nectar or not without going into the hive, but they were coming and going like madhouses, and some were bringing in pollen, some were coming in barehanded with no pollen, but I'm assuming they were bringing in nectar? Is that?
Probably, but they're gathering nectar, pollen, propolis, and water. So they could be hauling water, for that matter. But yeah, they could be hauling nectar. Some of them will haul pollen and nectar, and some of them will just be hauling pollen, and some of them will be hauling water, and some of them will be bringing in propolis.
But there's no way to really tell if they're bringing in nectar other than going to the hive and looking.
Well, I would say you can't tell for sure necessarily, but when you see them do crash landings because they're too heavy, it's kind of obvious. But they're not all doing crash landings, so it's not always so obvious. But sometimes you see the ones coming in all loaded, and it's like they misjudge it, you know, because they weigh more than they thought they did.
Yeah.
So, but other than that, I don't know that you can tell. But
break for lunch, sure.
Sure. Shall we take a break for lunch? Thank you.